This quick video is about a weird problem that I had when I first built this video editing computer. This was assembled back in May of 2019, and for the graphics card I chose this RTX 2080 that was on clearance because it was an open box item. It was about $200 off of retail, so it seemed like a good enough deal, and it was still covered under the manufacturer's warranty. After one or two initial hiccups, the computer seemed to be working perfectly. But as time went on, every once in a while, when the computer was powered on cold, it would shut off within a few minutes of use. Specifically, the screen would go black, and I could hear the graphics card fans go to full speed. Initially, I thought it might be some kind of a weird driver issue, but nothing turned up there, and I found all of these kernel power errors in the Windows Event Viewer. Since the problem only seemed to occur when the computer was cold, I never really lost any data because of it, and I would just let it warm up and then pretend it was never a problem. So, just like most of the issues on my cars, I ignored it until it became a bigger one. This took around 6 months. The issue was occurring more frequently, and it had started to do it even if the computer was warm. The graphics card temperature was always reported as being within normal levels, but it sure sounded like some sort of a hardware issue. I switched a different graphics card into the computer, and when that one didn't have any problems, I figured I would just try to RMA the RTX 2080. I had gotten the ASUS because of that significant discount, but it kinda came back to bite me when I could not get a successful submission of an RMA form, and I was not able to get in touch with any kind of customer service. At this point, I was pretty fed up with it, so I figured I would take a closer look. Once the problem started occurring more frequently, I was actually able to get this message out of the computer's BIOS. This pretty quickly pointed me in the direction of the power supply to the graphics card. And as soon as I started messing with it, I realized that wiggling this front power connector would cause the fans to go full speed and the screen to go blank. The rear power connector appeared fine, but entirely consistently the front one would cause this problem. To make sure it wasn't just a problem with the wires, I switched them front to back, and the issue was the same. For even more confirmation, I put the card in a different computer with a different motherboard and power supply, and it did the same thing. Just from what I could see from the outside, the solder joints on those power connectors didn't look amazing. So in order to take a better look, and actually do something about it, the card will have to come apart. I started off by removing the fan shroud, although it turned out that wasn't actually necessary. The shroud is held on with three screws on the side and one behind each of the fans. Then the wiring connector for the LED lights can be unplugged. As far as the screws that actually need to be removed, there are six that hold the fan and heat shield assembly to the main board. Four that should be loosened in a crisscross pattern that surround the GPU chip, and then two additional screws. Then we can separate those two main parts of the graphics card. Next, we have 12 more screws to remove that hold on the aluminum backing plate. Most of these are underneath that heatsink assembly, which is why that all had to be removed. And with all of the screws out of the way, that backing plate can be separated and its connector for the LED light in it can be disconnected. We finally have a good look at the through pins and solder connections for those power connectors. The solder looks a little funny, and it's a bit of a strange color, though there's nothing too obviously wrong with it. Also, this yellow material, which I initially thought was flux, appears to be some sort of epoxy resin. Whatever it is pretty cracked, which could indicate movement from those connections. I tried to use isopropyl alcohol and even a little bit of goof off to get that off of the board, but nothing was working. So even though it's not necessarily ideal, I figured I would just burn through it with the soldering iron and remove as much material as possible with the desoldering pen. And once they were all glooped back together, it was time to reassemble the graphics card. Since we separated it, the factory thermal paste would have to be replaced, and the easiest way to clean this off is with more isopropyl alcohol. With the chip and heatsink looking nice and shiny, we'll reinstall the back plate onto the main board, which means plugging back in that connector and reinstalling its 12 screws. Then we'll apply a blob of thermal paste right at the center of the chip, put the heatsink upside down, and carefully lower the main board onto it. Then we'll tighten down the four main heatsink screws in a crisscross pattern, along with the two additional heatsink screws. And finally, that fan shroud needs to be reinstalled as well. Once that connector is plugged back in and the 6 screws are reinstalled, we're ready to test this card out. And honestly, a bit to my surprise, after reinstalling it into the computer, it still works. But not only that, now both connectors can be wiggled and moved around without causing any problems. It's been a full year since performing this repair, and that black screen problem, fingers crossed, hasn't reoccurred a single time. It took some testing and fiddling and luck, but amazingly we were able to fix the problem. It was incredibly fortunate that it was such a simple one. I did actually end up taking the graphics card apart about 2 months later, but that was because of a heating issue. That thermal paste I had used the first time was the cheapest I had been able to find, and I usually use it for car parts. Apparently, there is a very big performance difference between that and the high-quality thermal paste that I ended up replacing it with. It went from 85 degrees Celsius, high fans, and performance throttling, down to 70 degrees Celsius with low-level fan noise even at 100% usage. Fortunately, after all of this, the computer has been working great. It seems like there's a good chance that this card was originally returned because the first owner had the same problem. They got out of it by just returning it to the store, but when my cheapskate ways gravitated me to the card, after a bit of time and effort, we were able to get the card working like it should have from the factory.